Hi, I'm Swally, and I want to introduce you to two talks I've created. Originally, I wanted to do a talk about the network hack for the C64, but in the preparation for this talk, I heard there was a request for how to create raster bars to have a small talk about this one, and this one was already lying around for something like 3 or 4 years. So I just threw it in there because the other talk is not so long at all, and I could do it to the price of one. So off you go. Okay, the first talk I'm going to do right now is about raster bars. It was entitled, "Yeah, it looks nice, but how did you do this?" And we're talking about the plasma effect from Wikipedia. It is explained as a computer-based visual effect animated in real time. It uses changing cycles of changing colors, warped in various ways to give the illusion of liquid organic movement. I'm going to skip the other part is interesting. Plasma can be implemented easily in software by using Zeno's tables and pseudocolor palettes. And it has also been considered one of the first true effects for many beginning demo coders. So I'm going to now go into the details of Zeno's tables and pseudocolor palettes, starting with the liquid. An annotation from me about this one: I'm showing just one way to do it. There are many ways. I'm using as an example a demo I did 3 years ago for the Atari VCS, where I had some quite nice implementation of raster bars or plasma effects. Some random notes. This is about why I did the talk in the first place. You can skip this one. This is an 8-bit implementation, so this is I did it on the Atari VCS, and the biggest limitation on this machine is that I can't do full effects or full resolution effects on the x-axis because the image is created while the beam travels along the screen. And it's also intended, when you have a machine with much more horsepower, something like a PC, you might want to come from another implementation, want to go another implementation, something like using floats. This is something I don't have on an 8-bit machine, but it shows the very nice, the basis of the effects. So yes, you can transfer it to another machine, whatever it might be. Tables in general, I'm using a 265-byte table as a function. This is something that can be easily done on an 8-bit machine because you just have to, just can throw in something. I've got one value that is between 0 and 255, and I can get back something in the same range of value. And this also, I can pre-calculate this one on a PC or something like this, just throw it into my ROM or code as well, and then use this one, and it's very fast in implementation. And this is something I need on the VCS to have it fast done. The Zeno's function is one of the demo coder's best friends. It makes movements seem natural. And the pseudocolor palette table, it matches the number, it matches a single number to a color value. On a C64, you just have 16 colors, so this would be on the C64 rather hard to implement in this way. But on the VCS, I have something like 104 colors. We get to this one a bit later on. And on an Amiga, where you have a much broader palette, then you can really decide on what to use on a color table. So let's start with the color table. Let's start with an easy implementation. We would go from a grayscale from 0 to 255, so from black to white, all the grayscales in there. The 2600 VCS doesn't provide this, but we have got a different color map. So let's take a deeper look in this one. This is what the color table for the NTSC looks like. Note that we have two values with the same color because they decided that the color change is not really visible in there, and they could ditch a transistor and so, or a couple of transistors if they just use half of the color table. That's possible. Palette looks a bit different, a bit pale, and also we have got a lot more grayscale because the color generation for PAL is much more complicated. But PAL is still something like a nice compromise for creating demos because you have less frames per second, but more you can put on a frame. And you can also go for a CCAM system, but then you are screwed in kinds of color table. So we want to create a better color table for the PAL system of the VCS. But we have something to use as a reference. So I'm thinking of the NTSC color palette as a reference. And to get this to this one, we first start separating up the color so that we use from the first one every second color in a row, and then the second half put it on the bottom. So the top half also looks already quite nice, but the bottom half, as we can see, it seems to be just reversed. So let's try a reverse one, and we're gonna get really close. But I'm not really satisfied with all the much grayscale, so I'm picking from the color table something that's as close as possible to the colors we've got on the NTSC machine. And then we can get to something like this. It looks quite nice. This is one way of finding a pseudo color palette table. On another machine, you would go another way. But this is something that's machine dependent. The machine independent part starts something about here, but maybe a bit later on. This is what it would look like if we were iterating through all colors of the C6 of the PAL table. So we can see all colors at once at the, and how it would like if we want to flash through every frame another color. It really looks nice. So if we're going to take a look on the newly implemented table, it still looks better, but the color gets brighter and then it gets suddenly black again. So this is also something that I wasn't really satisfied with, and I thought of another idea. Since every second value, the color gets brighter, I decided I use it for everyone. I just use a left half with all the colors, and for the right half, just go darker again. And now we've got some really natural looking flashing. And this is what my default color table looks like. And if you look in ROMs that I've released, you will probably find a page with these values which map the NTSC to PAL in a nice way that can be used for animation of colors. So now the second half, the Zenos table. I'm using a Zenos table that goes from 0 to 7f and really a Zenos function. And I'm starting as with Zenos in the middle. I'm not using the full value up to FF hexadecimal, but only to the half, because since I want to add several Zenos waves to one over one another, it saves me one step of then normalizing the result of this addition. So this is what this Zenos would look like if you animate it. And here we have a Zenos that has a higher frequency and only half of the height. And on the bottom half, we have something that has like, the full height, this is double the height. And we have got these two Zen wave functions. One has the triple of the frequency, and the other one has only the half of the amplitude. And now if we add these ones together, it looks like this. And this also, I think, looks already like a nice motion. And now if we just do something like tilt it, turn it 90 degrees clockwise, then we have for each line a nice value that we could use as an index for our color table. And then it would look something like this. That's it. That's all there is to RasterBars. It's really that simple. I noticed at the beginning when you could use a grayscale color tail, then it would look something like this. Not so exciting, I think, as this one, but it also shows these motions, these scene waves coming over each other. So this is what the original implementation looks like. I had a second just color cycling through the letters. And as you can really tell, it's really the same motion as we had in our example here. So it's really the same code, just not implemented in pseudocode as here, but really just from the machine. You could do something like this in two dimensions. Because if you just got only, or if you don't only go from line to line, but also from left to right and add something up, then you could get something like this. This is a rather simple function. And as I mentioned in the introduction, the VCS can't do something like doing 265 pixels in just one line. So I came up with the idea. I take squares of 16 by 16 pixels and then use the top left color and put it on there. In this one, we really got some nice motion, and then I started just experimenting, really trying different values for something like maybe use maybe make a higher frequency, a lower frequency, stuff like this. I was really just toying around with these options, and until I got a result that looks like this, I stopped. Said, okay, that's enough, that works for me. As you can see, there's a left-right motion. It's because I'm using also the Xenus function as an input for the input of the color of the Xenus wave that then gets introduced to the color table. So just another indirection from Xenus again, so I've got a left-right motion in there as well. And this came up with halt, something that looks, I think, rather nice. That's all to it as well. So I can only come to a conclusion. So doing such a demo effect is much easier as you might think. There are tons, really tons, of examples of Plasma code in there. With lots of examples, explanations, how it works, and what I can really say is just toy around, try to figure out what a parameter does and how you can fool around with it. Maybe you can also change something like a parameter by getting input from the sound you play so that you get a match in there, and really trying it is fun. And you can also do it on something like if you code an application and for the splash screen, something like this, to have a little bit of animation in there. That's really all that is to this. So that's the answer. That was it. Thank you for this one. But now to my main topic. In the last couple of years, I had the fun of toying around with something that's called the RNet MK3. This is a 10BASE-T network card that can be plugged into a C64 directly. It can be put onto a retro or Nordic replay using the clock port. Or it can be put on a Turbo Chameleon 64, which is an FPGA implemented C64 on steroids. So this is what the original firmware looks like when you start it up. And the only thing you can do is, you know, as you get, okay, if you hold the Commodore key at reset, then you can get CodeNet. This is what looks like this. You enter the IP address, and then a CodeNet server starts. This is all, and it also replies to ping or SMP packages, which is used by the command ping. So they can see that your C64 is really there. I wanted to have this firmware on the, oh, cool, that's an old version. I wanted to have this firmware on the Chameleon, but the original firmware only runs in native mode using its own unique bank switching, or for turning it on and off. It installs itself like a game ROM in the C64, where you have a register. If you write to this one, you turn it on, and if you have another one, if you write to this one, it turns it off. So how to get this one to the Chameleon? First step was I dumped the binary and loaded as a game ROM. It was very nice working at the first place, but since the hotspots are not supported, it does not turn off. And so you get stuff with a lot of applications that expect not to have a game ROM in there. Solution was to change the bank switching theme that's in there. And this took me a lot of time to browse through the Chameleon documentation on what bank switching themes are available there, or what ROM emulation is available there. And it really took me a long time to evaluate them all, and I was really blind, because of course you should use just the retro replay, because that's what's already been used for this card as well. The only exception is that I'm only using one bank and not four or the eight banks of the action or retro replay. So if you look at the manual, writing to D turns it on. When you want to dump the firmware, okay, I wrote a small basic program. It looks like this, and this is how you can get the firmware. Plain and simple. You just turn it on, put down the string, the top of the string memory, to below the ROM, mapped ROM area, so that you can use the file name as a variable, and then put it down from there. And then just write byte by byte off, and that's it. On my original attempt, I didn't use a basic program. I wrote a small assembler program, which I loaded there, but preparing for the talk, I noticed that doing it in basic is really obvious on how simple it is. If you've got questions, you can also throw it in there right now. So I wanted to have, since I got it dumped, I wanted to have more features. First of all, I wanted to have a firmware that runs on all configurations that are possible using this network card. So this, my first choice was the Chameleon, because I wanted to have a network card for this one. The native mode should also be still supported, so I didn't want to have a rivaling firmware card just for a retro replay or the Chameleon. I wanted to have DHCP, because I didn't want to type in every time another IP address. And I wanted to have something, a file transfer protocol that's more standard than CodeNet. CodeNet is something that has been implemented for specifically for the C64, so you need an own client for this one. This is practical because you can do a bit more than just uploading a file with this one, but I wanted also to be able to use really just a command line tool from Linux or Windows that would accomplish this. And it should preferably additionally to be to the CodeNet, so that the old stuff could be used again as well. And I wanted to have more verbosity, so that you can see a bit more on what happens.
Can you say a little bit more about the restrictions?
I will come to this one. I had to make compromises. These are the restrictions. Both retro replay and the native mode can coexist, so what I'm doing right there is switching both on and off together. So either the one will work and the other will go just to the null, or the other way around. So one will always work. So the original transfer buffer from the CodeNet implementation was only 128 bytes small. This is not enough if you want to do DHCP. DHCP packages do not have a fixed package size, as you have options yet that you can include, but rule of thumb is you need to have more than 265 bytes, so even more than a page. My in consideration, I wanted to use TFTP for transferring files, which is a UDP-based simple file transfer protocol, or trivial file transfer protocol as it's used, and it uses 512 bytes payload packages. Again, with some headers for the MAC address, IP frame, something like this, UDP. So we can come up with 558 bytes that I need. So I decided 648 bytes should be enough for everybody. And what I also... No, he said kilobytes. and I put it on the screen memory for more verbosity. So what do we have now in this cartridge, in my current implementation? We have got both. You can do basic DHCP, so it's not everything from the standard supported, but enough to get things running. And we've got static IP addresses. We've got a stack that only does UDP packages, not TCP packages, so something like a Telnet or an FTP or HTTP is not possible with this stack. We've got support for CodeNet, the transfer protocol that's listening on port 6264. We've got UDP slave, which is an implementation by Margervalp, which is very similar to the CodeNet. They also have the same concept, same package size, or same maximum package size of 128 bytes. They've got all really similar stuff in there. Only the protocol in itself is slightly different. They are using other values for indicating what kind of package it is and something like this. But they are really alike. And we've got TFTP, which is a standardized file transfer that you can use with the command line tool from Linux, and also implemented a bit for toying around the echo port. Echo means if you put something in there, you get a reply from the address you've written to, get it back. Implemented for two ways. First of all, as something like have something a bit more than ping, ping on a UDP seam, something like this. You can think of it as ping for UDP. And also, this is a nice basis if you want to implement another protocol for some whatever you want. So this you can use as a template to put your own code about if you want to implement a fourth protocol or fifth protocol in the same ROM again. So now it looks like this. The startup screen is a bit tinier because I've put the whole copyright stuff in a separate screen, help menu. That again will be triggered if you press Control. I've still kept to the original. Pressing Commodore, you get the mode where you can enter an IP4 address. And pressing the left shift button, also you can use shift lock, that's why I chose this one, will get you to DHCP directly. And some copyright messages in there, also the transfer protocol that I used. And this is what the screen looks like if you run it, if you run it in DHCP mode. It would almost look the same just to have an IP address before. And if you can take a look, the first one, some for a bit comfort to the C64 will know that this is FF as a screen value. Then this is a broadcast address for Mac. We've seen here there's a bracket, an opening bracket. This is 28. And let's take it, skip one and take the L. This is a screen code for C. As you can see, oh, this is from the MAC address, 28 for C. So this is the MAC address from the send packet. What you see there is really the Ethernet frame that has been transmitted from the C64 onto the Ethernet. So you have got there your something like lightweight C64 Wireshark. And it really helped me debugging. It really helped me debugging this whole stuff. So we need more to get this thing running. We need additional tools. We need tool for configuring the firmware, because no two firmwares are the same. You might want to change the default IP address, but you definitely have to change the MAC address, because we are not allowed to have two MAC addresses on the same bus. And I also wanted to add support for the versions of the RRNet without ROM, so that you can use an older version using the Retro Replay or the Chameleon. I've had two options for solving this one. Either to have a tool that modifies and writes the firmware again, or what I really chose was I have a tool that already contains the firmware, customizes it, and then writes this customized firmware onto a floppy. This is what the creation process looks like. So at first you get introduced that you have to enter an IP address, what you want to have for default, then you have to enter the MAC address. The cursor starts on the second last, but you can go back and edit everything, but I wouldn't recommend this. The first three letters are, first three values are the vendor ID, and this is the vendor ID of individual computers who did the network card. The FF is an indication that you're using a retro replay, and these are from the original firmware, the values from my network card, so you know my MAC address. Heavy fun hacking. If you, and you also would see that the MAC address has been detected. This is because you see there some debugging information. On the ROM port, there has been detected this stuff, the values, and the last two one are checksums that validate the former two, so that you can really tell that it's not just some random data, but really a verified MAC address. And these are, these would be also readable on the I/O port of the network card if you plug it on top of a retro replay or a chameleon. This is from an emulator where I was emulating the hardware or the native mode. So there is no stuff like this in there. If you don't have a matching address in either of these ones, then you get presented with a default MAC address. The default MAC address has something like zero in the second to last, and the last one is a pure random number, so that you can take what you get in there and just write it out. If you really want to do want to have your own numbers so you could identify it easier, I would recommend to use a 01 for the second to last value. So after you've chosen the configuration, you can decide if you want to dump it as an 8K ROM value, ROM image, or as a CRT image. We'll get for the selection we get later on. Here we are writing a ROM image so that it can flash in there into the native mode of a network card. Again, so for this one we need a tool as well. This just loads the file, really from the name you can choose. It's either RNet MK3.ROM or .CRT. And the software that writes the tool also uses this file name, RNet.C.ROM, loads it from the floppy, calculates for debugging purposes of the flashing process a CRC, and then writing the stuff from 8,000 hex to 9FFF hex. That's it. And then you've got the new image on there. But what about the other platforms that are supported? The Turbo Chameleon, since the config tool can also write CRT images, you just can load the CRT image and it will enable retro replay mode, and you can get all what you want, or you really just have to select it, and then you've got the firmware and it's running. The retro replay, you use the same file and flash it with the standard tools that are available for the retro replay or Nordic replay for flashing. And for other hardware which emulate retro replay, you have to look up the manual on what you have to do to get this one CRT installed in this one as well. It comes with a freeze button, the replays and the Turbo Chameleon. And at first, hitting the freeze button crashed the system. So I dug a bit into this one. What happened there? Well, the ROM that's usually at 8,000 hex gets mapped to E000 like a kernel, and an NMI is triggered, so it's jumping to the address pointed at FFFA. So if you look in there, there's at this address, there's the MAC address and the checksum. And on the MAC address, FFFA is FF4C. So what I said, okay, I can work with this one, FF4C now contains some weird routine that just turns it off and triggers a reset. So if you're gonna use, if you press the trigger button on a retro replay, the whole hardware gets turned off as a reset, so you have really a vanilla C64 machine until you press reset to enable it again. also implemented a nice hack, I would call it. I can hijack the communication between the DHCP server sending me the TFTP name that's, that it should use on booting. So if you call this 333, file name, this file name gets written to the memory, and then it enables the cartridge and does a jump to a routine, which I've put in a jump table inspired like the C64 kernel that implements right now four routines. So this is the first one. The first one is TFTP load from basic. What it does, it takes the IP address of the TFTP server that is sent from PXE booting. Sorry. This file name has to be stored in the area that the stub already copied in there. It has to be null terminated if it is shorter, which is also done in this way. But what I really implemented it for is that you can do something like DHCP, TFTP driven boot menu, so that you can do something like put a display of four C64s where people can sit on and play one-filer games or see one-filer demo, something like this. And all they have to do is press reset, hold shift, get presented with a menu, then can select from this menu what they really want to run, and then this one will start it. A big problem in there is that PETSCII and ASCII are not quite compatible. I chose a small compromise. I only change the case of a letter on this one. Okay, this one. I've also included almost everything, every tool I use. I include my own print routine, which is inspired by the original action replay. It is used that you can just jump to subroutine print, then put the stuff that should be printed right afterwards, let it end with a zero, and then the code gets executed after printing it out, right in the line below. There also are two other options. You can do a reduced length encoding so that you can say if you want to print something like 40 stars, then you can say just print me the star 40 times. And you can also set the cursor on a different, on a defined position. Since when you want to do a menu or something like this, the data you've gotten, you have to print out. So I've added also a routine for printing ASCII data, which does not more than switching between the capitals of, or the capitalization of the ASCII text. The text has to be zero terminated and it will not be modified. But since you don't have to want to include your data in the source code, what you want to print, I'm using A and Y, or the accumulator and Y, for determining the low and high address. You can, since I've already needed a routine to convert ASCII to PETSCII for the TFTP, this one has also been made available for tools use, and also has to be in. And this time, of course, the data has to be modified. We are using, again, the accumulator and the Y register for the address. But PETSCII defines two regions of uppercase. So calling this routine twice not necessarily will reproduce the original data. I also added some nice features after you loaded something. I left some useful information in the memory. The RAM, in the RAM, the IP address, these are the labels used in the firmware. The RAM, in the RAM, the IP address. This is the IP address this has been used for transfer. So it's not the default IP address. It is the default IP address if this has been used, but if you have gotten another IP address via DHCP, then you will get this one in there. Then you've got the whole MAC address in there, and you've got the checksum in there, though, so that in this case you can decide if you've got the real data in there, as well as you can detect if the last two bytes of the MAC address are correct from the ROM or from the mirror of the ROM in the I/O area. How the checksum is calculated, this is available in the wiki describing the RNet MK3. These addresses might change, but I think they won't, because this is the IP address of the server you've been communicating with via TFTP or DHCP, and the MAC address of the remote. This is mainly because I have to put them somewhere and I don't clean the map afterwards, but they might be used for some tools afterwards. So I've got still some things to do on this one. The source code is available in the official individual computer subversion repository. So I'm doing this for them so that they can have at some point chip the card with a better firmware than the original one. But since there are still some problems, we are not quite there yet. I want to split up the code into several files, since the code originated in me throwing the ROM image in the disassembler and then starting to add my stuff in there and changing the code afterwards. So I don't think there's any original line in there left, but since it was an evolutionary process, it's still in one file. I'm in the progress of splitting this into several stuff, so I have here something for TFTP in an own source code file, the Echo server in an own file for better access, understanding of the source code. There's a lot of testing to be done, since only testing can reveal that there are still bugs in there. This testing resulted in me completely for implementing really for the first time some kind of resend code. Because UDP is connectionless, the protocol defines that you have to resend packages if you don't get an acknowledge on a protocol level. And this was something that's got me a bit in a of trouble using DHCP, because DHCP requires me that I do a re-request of the of my IP address in a kind of way in a time span that the DHCP server tells me to. In this case, I've done a compromise, because I didn't want to pass all this one, use timer to get this one. What I did is I did some hard implementation in there. I just every 2 minutes I say, okay, I want to have this IP address, please give it to me again. And this is so far, mostly the stack isn't running for something like 30 seconds, because you start it, you put what you want onto the C64, and then the stack ends. So this doesn't do anything bad in the end. So at the first implementation, there was never a resending code in any way. So I just said, it's not a use case of the stack of this ROM. But since I had at some point a network setup that was really buggy, so the packages got lost, I didn't really get a DHCP address because there was no resend. So I started after this one to really everything that needs to be have a resend, like TFTP needs to have a resend if you can't get an acknowledge. Everything has been implemented as well as there. This is the last thing I've done so far. We still have one really big bad bug in there, which I can't really put my finger on, because I can't reproduce it at home. An individual computer, a network setup there, a package sent to the hardware appears in Wireshark. So the request is sent out. Give me an DHCP address, then the first answer comes in, the answer is sent, you see it in Wireshark, but in the hardware of the in the chip itself, I can't detect that there's a package. On the other hand, If you use the original firmware, this works in the same network setup. So I can't really put my finger on what's the problem in there. It is not a hardware problem. It must be some kind of software of setup, something like this. And I've really put the old code, my code, side by side, and then gone through what I'm doing, and I can't find any difference. So if you want to dig in there and maybe point me out where I'm stupid, show me. It's welcome. But as an excuse, I want to show you a bug that was a real bitch. To handle the hardware, that the chip is intended as an was originally intended for ISA DOS PCs. The ISA is a 16-bit bus or 16-bit architecture. So on a C64, you have two I/O addresses that you have to write your data to alternating if you want to store the data that has to be sent. My idea, okay, I define that the memory is aligned. I say my buffer starts at the screen and the last bit of this one is even, so it is aligned. And now I can use the lowest bit of this address to add to the data port. I think this is something that the original firmware didn't do, and I think it was a really clever way to do this. But my code crashed. Only in native mode. It took me even weeks to discover that I've got a bug in there because I was only coding it on the Chameleon. So just to get to this bug, I need to warm up for 6502 assembler. I'll show you the subroutine I use to increment a pointer and compare to the compare if the end is reached. This is a subroutine I need for selecting the data I want to write to the hardware. So I'm incrementing the lower half of my 16-bit pointer. If it's not equal, not zero, then I don't have to increment the higher 8 bits of this pointer. So I skip this instruction, and then I compare the lower end. If they are not equal, I'm already done. If they are equal, I also have to compare the upper half. And if they are, then this routine would also be left with the zero flag set. And in the other case, it would be left with the zero flag cleared. So the code that failed, this was my first implementation. I'm using my pointer. I'm masking out the lowest bit, putting this one into the X register, loading the pointer to the data that I really wanted to have. Since this is zero, it is always loaded from the place where the pointer is stored. Then I'm writing this one to the data port, adding the X register. Then the subroutine I introduced, I'm increment all my pointers through all the checks. And if I'm not reached the end, I start again. The C label shows where it crashed. And I was really racking my brain, why would a store command crash? I've been coding C64 for quite some time, and I haven't seen it that a store command would crash a C64. This is the code after I discovered the bug that works. Again, I'm loading some. This time, I'm loading the pointer, and I'm shifting it out so the carry gets the first, gets the least significant bit. Then I get only my pointer again, and then I'm branching, skipping either the even or the odd writing of this stuff, and I'm doing the addition, the adding of the offset really hard in the source code, and then doing the check and then crashing out. Has anybody any idea why this one works and the other one didn't? Raise a hand. Okay, no. I just want this just for the note, one person raised his hand. And when I've done explaining, because I've really done a nice explanation and I don't want to spoil it, just tell me if it is what you thought. So what does the opcode on every clock cycle it's executing? On the first clock cycle, it's reading the opcode. On the second, it's reading the low byte of the address. On the third, it's reading the high byte of the address. And adds the X register to the low byte. after this one, it takes an extra clock cycle to add the carry to the high byte, and then it writes to the accumulator to the calculated address. There's something odd in there, because something just doesn't match, I think. Every time we have a read or write, except for the adding part, the carry. So this, and every time, on every clock cycle, the CPU either has to access the bus, it has to read, has to write something. So what really happens is, it reads the opcode, it reads the low byte address, reads the high byte address, it does a dummy read from the current address without the carry, and adding the carry to the high byte for writing it afterwards. So the hardware was not capable of handling, on one clock cycle, reading from an I/O address, and after just one clock cycle later, writing to this one. This was just an implementation, a bug in the hardware, which I had to circumvent in software. So was what you thought? Ghost write? Go to the ghost read? Yeah. So the one was right. So this concludes my small excursion through the slides. First of all, I want to say a big thank you to Individual Computers who really supported me on writing this firmware. I had a very first prototype, was showing this one to Jens, and he was, as he saw what I was trying to do, he was astonished. He really said, okay, we have to get this one in the product, please do continue, I will help you. Just for testing, I'll give you a Nordic replay so that you can test this one, this configuration as well. So you can also do, and also Tobias will support you if you have any troubles with hardware, stuff like this. And Tobias was the one that implemented into the Vice emulator the bank switching code for the original hardware, the native code hardware. And really, I extended this implementation with really printing out where a read, where a write happens. And I didn't think of this ghost read problem until I really had in the log file that I've written the ghost read just about this one. And even staring at these two lines, it took me about something like half a minute to really recognize what was going on there. So, and of course, I want to thank you for listening, because talking to myself is rather boring. I've tried it before. But one more thing. I can show the whole thing to you, at least in one configuration, in action. So, let's take a look at the options. As you can see from the cartridge settings, slots, these are the original retro replay slots, which are originally put to play in there, and I've got a retro replay also in there. This is carrying my my implementation for the network card. So if I'm going to start this with this firmware, you'll see the message. You can see if I press Control or Alt. It's almost all the control. You know, there is. This is what the message looks like, a bit more and a bit bigger on the screen. You can see what you can do. There's also a hidden feature in there. As you can see, the Chameleon is when using this firmware, the Chameleon is using maximum CPU power. And if you press O, you can drop it down to original one so that you can compare transfer speeds if you want to do some measurement. So let's leave it again. Let me show you my implementation for doing DHCP, loading the stuff. And TFTP is the fastest protocol to get your code onto the cartridge or onto the C64 because of less overhead. Since 512 bytes are transferred in each package and no handshaking has to be done in between these 512 bytes, it's a bit faster. So let me just put on dum-da-dum-dum-dum. So you've got a Telnet client, and VT100, and voila, we have now been logged onto my private little C64 server, which was serving the DHCP, which was serving the TFTP server, so you can take a look at, wrong key. The mapping is quite strange. I'm not going to use completion anymore. So let's do telnet. Telnet, this Kipper term comes with its own IPsec implementation. So we can do, as you can see, TCP connection is there as well. Serve TFTP, and as you take a look in there, okay, let's take it short. KT is a link to tool skipper term. We've got some demos in there. So as we can see, okay, demos. There are some one filers in there. And if we leave this one, we can also use demos. Let's use for crawl. So you can use it, I think, like a super powered tape or something like this. It doesn't compare to a floppy, but it's quite nice to play with. Any questions? Damn. I lost them all. Though. Okay, then. Again, thank you. Just go, just go, just to make a crowd, just go.